So most patients with an irregular heartbeat will start to experience some palpitations, feeling a skipped or irregular heartbeat. The most common symptom, and what we don't usually recognize as an arrhythmia, is actually going to be short of breath or just low energy levels. Things that used to be pretty easy, bringing in the groceries, going up a flight of stairs, all of a sudden become much more difficult to patients.
The most common rapid heartbeat in the world is atrial fibrillation, which is an irregular heartbeat. And I would say that a third of the patients that we see in our practice have this condition.
Atrial fibrillation can cause a stroke, and the reason for that is because the top chamber of the heart is not getting a good contraction. It's fibrillating, and when it fibrillates, it causes blood to become static and not move, and that's how clots form. And if it gets pumped out of the heart, one of the potential places it goes is to the brain, and that would cause a stroke.
An arrhythmia is any type of abnormal heartbeat. Some patients that see us are also patients with heart failure that we can recommend putting in some type of implant in order to help the function of their heart. Some patients also need pacemakers whenever the heartbeat gets too low, and that'll also be a patient that would see us.
One of the most common symptoms patients experience is what they call fluttering, or they feel palpitations where they'll feel extra heartbeats. Other times, symptoms that patients have are they just don't feel well, decrease in energy, fatigue. So arrhythmias can really present in many different symptoms.
The vast majority of the patients, it's an acquired condition. And the main risk factors are hypertension, high blood pressure, diabetes, high blood sugar, obesity or overweight, and a condition that has become more prevalent lately called obstructive sleep apnea, by which patients snore at night, they obstruct their airway, and that has been associated with an increased risk of atrial fibrillation.
The most important aspect is, one, diagnosing you with a heart arrhythmia. After that, you can see a cardiologist who may say it's appropriate to be seen by a cardiac electrophysiologist. However, if your primary care physician also has diagnosed you with a heart arrhythmia, it's very reasonable to go straight to a cardiac electrophysiologist to determine different treatment options for them.
When we have any type of arrhythmia, we always know that there's what we term a short circuit, or an area of abnormal electrical conduction in the heart. The ablation procedure is when we take another catheter, which is now a curative catheter, and we deliver some type of energy into the heart. And there's various types of energy we can use depending on the type of arrhythmia. Once we do that, then many times we can offer the patient a cure for the arrhythmia, or certainly significant reduction in symptoms, or what we call their burden of the arrhythmia.
It is a long road to become a cardiac electrophysiologist. We do 4 years of college, 4 years of med school, 3 years of internal medicine residency, then 3 years of cardiology, and then 2 additional years of a subspecialty fellowship in electrophysiology. So med school and post-med school training, it ends up being 12 years.